Hello viewers, in my last lecture I had introduced fructose to you. So what is fructose? We know fructose has molecular formula C6H12O6. It is functional isomer of glucose. It is sweetest of all monosaccharides. In fact, it is 2 times sweeter than sucrose. Since fructose is present in fruits, it is also known as fruit sugar. Fructose is the most soluble monosaccharide. That is, it is most soluble in water. It is a naturally occurring ketohexose, and since it is found in fruits like berries and honey also, so it is also known as fruit sugar. We know that sugarcane and sugar beets are rich sources of these sugars. That is, it occurs in combination with sucrose and glucose in nature. If we want to obtain this fructose commercially, it can be obtained by hydrolysis of sucrose. So when we carry out hydrolysis of sucrose, it is carried out with dilute acid. We know sucrose is a disaccharide made up of glucose and fructose. So when it is hydrolyzed, it breaks down to give us glucose and fructose. What do we mean by saying hydrolysis? Hydro means that the reaction is brought about with the help of water, and lysis means that we are breaking the bond. So if you look into the structure of the how we bring about hydrolysis of sucrose, as you can see on your screens, sucrose is a disaccharide. And when we talk of the glycosidic linkage here, what we find that at this glycosidic linkage between glucose and fructose will cleave, and the water will bring about this cleavage. The H of the water makes a bond with the oxygen of glucose, and the OH adds to the enomeric carbon of the fructose unit. And what we get here is, on hydrolysis, we get glucose and fructose. This glucose fructose can be separated, the mixture, by bringing about the fractional distillation with alcohol. As you know, glucose is only sparingly soluble in alcohol, so it gets separated first in form of crystals, and later on we get crystals of fructose from the filtrate. Now, the second method by which fructose can be prepared commercially is from inulin. Inulin is a polysaccharide found in many plants in nature, in roots or rhizomes of chicory and artichoke. You know what? This inulin is a storage carbohydrate. We know in plants, the storage carbohydrates can be starch or inulin, whereas cellulose is a structural carbohydrate. So it has been observed that the plants which have inulin as a storage polysaccharide do not have starch, or they have very little amount of starch in them. And since chicory and artichoke are rich sources of inulin, so we bring about the hydrolysis. That is, we first extract inulin from these plants, and then the hydrolysis is carried out with dilute sulfuric acid, when it will give us fructose. So, and the now how do we separate fructose from the mother liquor? So we say that fructose can be separated from the mother liquor by, that is, we take the solution and we treat it with barium hydroxide solution. And when we treat it with barium hydroxide solution, a white precipitate of barium sulfate is obtained, which is filtered and separated. So in the filtrate, now we get when we concentrate the filtrate, we get the crystals of fructose. Now I would like to discuss the properties of fructose with you. But before discussing the properties of fructose with you, I would like to discuss how can we represent fructose. Because after we are familiar with the property, with the structure of fructose, then only will we be able to understand the properties of fructose. As you can see on your screens, fructose has been represented by five structures. The structure, the middle structure, is the Fischer structure. And you know, in Fischer structure, we write the longest carbon chain as the vertical chain with the highest oxidized end at the top. But since in this condition, the highest oxidized end, the oxidized end is carbonyl group, that is the ketonic group. So this cannot be at number one, this is at number two. And then we have the rest of the hydroxyl groups are attached to the carbons here. The vertical lines represent the bonds which are going away from the observer, and horizontal lines represent the bonds which are coming towards the observer. And since it has six carbons in it, so we call it as hexose. And since it has a ketonic group, it is known as ketohexose. And then please remember, this molecule has configuration capital D, because the OH on the highest numbered asymmetric carbon is on the right hand side. So now when we talk of this structure, what you observe that this molecule has a ketonic group as well as five hydroxyl groups. So that means since it has a carbonyl group, it will show us the properties of ketones. And we know that ketones react with alcohols in presence of dilute hydrochloric acid to give us hemiacetal. And then that hemiacetal reacts with second molecule of alcohol to give us a ketyl. So when we are talking of ketones, we get ketyls and hemiketyls and ketyls. And when we talk of aldehydes, we get hemiacetals and acetals. Now, when we look into this molecule, what we find that this has a ketonic group as well as five alcoholic groups in it. So if it has five alcoholic groups, that means that we can have intramolecular hemiketal formation. So because of that hemiketal formation, this can occur in two ring forms. Here I have shown the Haworth structures. The first structure that you can see on your screen is the furanose structure. And why do we call it as furanose? Because furane, it has the basic structure of the molecule is that of the heterocyclic ether, that is furan. Why do we call it as heterocyclic ether? Because one of the ring atoms is other than carbon. So this molecule has the structure, the basic structure is that of furan. So this is called as furanose. O's indicates that this is a carbohydrate. And when we write fructo, fructo indicates that it is a cyclic structure, that is Haworth structure of fructose. Then I have written alpha D. I'll be explaining these terms very shortly. So this structure, because of cyclization in the open chain structure here, what we find that this structure can be represented in two forms, which are the furanose forms. That is, this ring is five-membered ring. And the other way in which we can represent fructose is in a pyranose structure. In pyranose structure, what we find that this ring is six-membered. And here, the basic structure is that of pyrene. That is, basic structure of ring is that of pyrene. And again, we know that pyrene is a heterocyclic compound. That is, it is a cyclic ether. So again, because of cyclization, That is, we can get two isomers because of this cyclization. So if the cyclization is taking place between the second carbon and the fifth carbon, that is the hydroxyl group of the fifth carbon and the carbonyl group, we get a five-membered ring. And if the cyclization takes place due to reaction between the OH on the sixth carbon and the carbonyl group on the second carbon, we get a six-membered ring. So now let us see, how does this reaction take place, or how does this the other way? Now this is the Haworth structure, that is for fructofuranes, which we've written here, and this is the cyclic structure. Now what happens in the course of reaction? So we can represent fructose by so many structures. That is the open chain structure. Then we have the ring structure, which very clearly shows that in the ring structure, when the ring is being formed, the reaction is taking place between the OH on the fifth carbon and the ketonic group on the second carbon, resulting in a five-membered ring. Then we can represent this structure by a Haworth projection, and this is the actual representation of the fructose molecule. Now we have, how does this reaction take place, or why does this reaction take place? As I've already said, that the cyclic structure will result because the fructose has a ketonic group at C2 carbon and it has an alcoholic group at C5 carbon. It has alcoholic group, in fact, at 3, 4, 5 and 6 carbons. But the reaction will take place between the C2, that is the carbonyl group, and the hydroxyl group at the 5th carbon. So when these two groups react with each other, it results in a form of cyclic hemiketal. So the cyclic structure of fructose is also known as hemiketal, and we call this structure as a fructofuranoyl structure when we are representing it in form of Haworth projection. So in this case, as I've already said, the reaction will take place between the hydroxyl group on the fifth carbon and the ketonic group at the second carbon. Now what you can see here, now when we are carrying out the reaction, now we have to draw the Haworth projection. So how will we draw the Haworth projection for fructose? So the best way to write it is that we write it in a lateral position, sideways position, and these bonds which are being expressed by bold lines are the bonds which are coming towards the observer. And now we orient this molecule in such a way that the hydroxyl group at the fifth carbon is facing the carbonyl group. Now we know that this carbonyl groups is this group is sp2 hybridized, and since it is sp2 hybridized, that means the structure will be planar, right? And now we know that oxygen is more electronegative than carbon. Since oxygen is more electronegative than carbon, it will pull the electrons towards itself, as a result of which this carbon will have a partial positive charge. And since it will have a positive charge, that means this carbon is now electrophilic in nature. It is electron deficient, and oxygen has lone pair of electrons on it. So now this oxygen will make a bond with this carbon, right, resulting in a ether, cyclic ether. Between the bond is being formed between the second carbon and the hydroxyl group on the fifth carbon. Now since it is planar, now here the rotation was restricted since it has a double bond, but once it has formed a bond here, the rotation becomes free. Now since the rotation becomes free, we say that this H plus can now add to this oxygen from either face, resulting in two stereoisomers, and these two stereoisomers are known as enomers. So how does this reaction take place? So what we have is that when we carry out this reaction, what we've done is we've created a new chiral carbon. And now when we have a new chiral carbon, this will result in the two arrangements of CH2OH group and the OH group on the enomeric carbon. So what we find is that is we will have two isomers, that is alpha D fructofuranase and beta D fructofuranase are the stereoisomers which will be result due to form reaction between the OH on the fifth carbon and the ketone group on the second carbon. So this is what I've shown you again, that is we have a open chain structure here. Reaction is taking place between the OH on the fifth carbon and the ketone group, the carbon of the ketone group on the second carbon, resulting in two structures, two cyclic structures. Now, when we look into these two cyclic structures, what we find that in all of the other carbons, that is at second carbon, third carbon, sixth, fifth carbon, here the configuration is same. The configuration is only different at the newly formed chiral carbon. And in one structure, that means we are now getting two stereoisomers. And these two stereoisomers are called as enomers. So what are enomers? Enomers are special type of epimers which differ in configuration at C2 in case of hemiketals. Now what we find that in this structure, what we find, now we will compare the relationship of this CH2OH and this OH. If this CH2OH and OH are on the opposite side, or we can say if the OH is on the lower side of the ring, this is known as alpha form. That is alpha D we are talking, because of the configuration of fructose in open chain structure was D, and we are calling it furanose because the basic structure, the ring structure here, is that of furan, which is a heterocyclic ether, which is a heterocyclic compound, that is it is a cyclic ether, that is it is aromatic in nature. Now when we talk of the other structure, what we find that in this case the enomeric OH and the CH2OH are on the same side of the ring. So this is called as the beta form, and as I've made it clear here, why is it called beta? Because the orientation or the configuration of the OH is on the top of the ring, fructo, because it is the cyclic structure of fructose, furan, because the basic ring resembles the cyclic ether furan, and O's because we are indicating that it is a carbohydrate. And now another point that you have to keep in mind, which is the enomeric carbon. In case of fructose, the second carbon here is the enomeric carbon, because this is the carbon which is directly attached to two oxygens. That is, it is attached to this oxygen as well as this oxygen. Now, let us look as to how does, here I have shown again the cyclic structures of beta D fructose and alpha D fructose. And then we will go on to when we are representing them in the Haworth projections. In Haworth, this will be the beta because the OH is on the top side of the ring, and this will be the alpha because OH is on the lower side of the ring. That is, these groups are opposite, and here these two groups are on the same side. Now, but we can also, there's another alternative, there's another position, and that position is that is when the OH on the sixth carbon reacts with this carbonyl group. And the reaction will be same. So when the OH on the sixth carbon will react with the carbonyl group at the second position, that is the ketonic position, we will get a six-membered ring. And again, we will get two forms, the alpha form and the beta form. Here I have shown you the alpha form. So in alpha form, we find that this OH is on the lower side of the ring. And this six-membered ring is known as pyranose. Why is it known as pyranose? Because it has the basic structure of pyrene in it, and it is known as fructo because it is derived from fructose. So that means the fructose molecule can exist in two cyclic forms. One is the pyranose structure, which is this one, and the other is the furanose structure. And you will observe that when we study disaccharide, oligosaccharide and polysaccharide, there the ring, the fructose ring, is represented in the furanase form. As I showed you earlier on also, the hydrolysis of sucrose, which was giving us glucose and fructose, there also the fructose was present in form of furanose ring. So I hope the structures of the fructose molecule are clear. That is, we have an open chain structure, we have a cyclic structure, and then we have Haworth projections for the cyclic structures. Now I would like to discuss the physical properties of fructose with you. And we know fructose is a white crystalline solid. Its melting point is 103 to 105 degrees Celsius, which is lower than that of glucose. And the molecular mass of fructose is 180 moles per gram, and its density is 1.69 grams centimeter square. And you have to remember that fructose is the sugar which is most soluble in water. And the naturally occurring fructose is levorotatory. Now, what I mean by saying, why is it levorotatory? Because it will rotate the path of plane polarized light in left hand direction. So this molecule has configuration capital D, but it is levorotatory. So what do we conclude from this? That if a molecule is having configuration capital D, it is not necessary that it will always be dextrorotatory. It can be levorotatory also. That means capital D is indicating the orientation of OH on the highest numbered asymmetric carbon, that is, OH is on the right hand side, whereas small l or small d indicates the direction of rotation of plane polarized light. And fructose also, the next thing that we have to remember, normally when we talk of specific rotation of a molecule, we say its specific rotation is constant. But when we find that if we dissolve fructose in water, its optical rotation keeps on changing with time till it attains a constant value. And this phenomena is known as mutarotation. That means fructose, glucose, all these molecules, they undergo ring opening in water, and the rotation keeps on changing, and this is known as mutarotation. Now, another very interesting fact about fructose is that when we eat some, and this is very important in food industry. Why is it important in food industry? That sometimes when we are eating roasted and baked foods, these roasted and baked foods have a distinctive flavor. And when we talk of the crust of the bread, or when we look at biscuits or cakes, we find that they have a golden brown layer on it, golden brown crust. Why is it so? This is because of a special kind of reaction which is known as Maillard reaction. I'll be discussing the details of Maillard reaction in my next lecture. Thank you.